Welcome to the latest edition of the Geo Legend video interview series. This episode featuring Professor Robert D. Holtz. My name is Steve Kramer, and I'm grateful for the opportunity to speak for the first time after 2 years of COVID-induced separation with my good friend and colleague, Bob Holtz. I've known Bob for over 35 years, first through the U-Sugar Executive Committee, and for the past 34 years as a colleague in the geotechnical group at the University of Washington. Bob's had a huge impact on my career and on the careers of many others, and it's a pleasure to help other Geo-Institute members get to know him a little better. Bob, I'm going to start off by running through a little of your background and accomplishments, and then we'll go through some of that history in more detail. Bob Holtz received his Bachelor of Science degree from the University of Minnesota in 1960, after which he entered the graduate program and completed a master's degree in 1962. He then worked on Oroville Dam with the California Department of Water Resources for a couple years before taking an assistant professorship at California State University, Sacramento. After about 18 months, he left Sacramento State to pursue his PhD degree at Northwestern University, which he received in 1970. He then spent 3 years as a research engineer at the Swedish Geotechnical Institute in Stockholm. In 1973, Bob accepted a position as assistant professor in the geotechnical program at Purdue University, one of the top programs in the country at that time. Over the next 15 years, Bob was promoted eventually to full professor. He taught, conducted research, was very active in ASCE and other professional organizations, and co-wrote with his colleague Bill Kovacs the famous textbook, An Introduction to Geotechnical Engineering, which is widely used around the world. During that period, Bob spent summers and sabbaticals working on research and with consulting firms in Sweden, France, Canada, and Italy. In 1988, Bob made a career and life change, moving from the plains of Indiana to the mountains, lakes, and rain of Seattle, joining the University of Washington's Small Geotechnical Group, where I had been one of two faculty members for the previous 4 years. Bob brought instant credibility to our program and worked tirelessly to build it up to its current stature. Bob retired from the University of Washington in 2008 and has been Professor Emeritus since that time. Bob is well known for many research contributions, but likely best for his work with geosynthetics, an area in which he has been for many years a leading authority, publishing books, manuals, reports, and handbooks on that subject. He's the author of more than 270 technical publications, including 22 books and book chapters. He has lectured and conducted short courses and workshops on geosynthetics across the country and around the world, at least 28 countries by my count. He's received many honors and given many distinguished lectures. He was a Cross Canada lecturer in 1999 and gave the 46th Terzaghi Lecture in 2010. Bob has a long history of involvement with ASCE and the Geo Institute and was named a Distinguished Member of ASCE in 2007. So, Bob, you are a Geo Legend. Welcome to your Geo Legend interview.
Well, thank you, Steve, and it's a pleasure to see you. Even remotely, because it has been, 2 years? I miss our lunches that we used to have at the faculty club and telling stories and what each of us was doing. I really do miss that. So this is a pleasure to, even if it's not about you a little bit or much, it'll still be fun to go through it. So fire away.
Okay. Well, let's start. At the beginning, tell me a little bit about your family, your childhood, and your early education, what subjects you were interested in the most and hobbies and that sort of thing.
Okay. Well, I was born in Tucson, Arizona, but I only lived there for 10 days. In those days, they kept mothers in the hospital for a long time, not like now where they get them out as fast as they can. My dad was with the Indian Bureau over at Sells, Arizona, which is about 75 miles from Tucson, on the Papago Indian Reservation, which has a different name nowadays. I don't know what it's called now. And we moved around several times while I was in grade school or before to different reservations in Arizona and in New Mexico. I spent the first time I was kind of aware of what was going on, I was at the beginning of WW2, and we were living in Mescalero, New Mexico, and We took a ride up to Ruidoso, which is now a well-known ski resort and everything. It was a one main street town at that time. They had a roller rink for roller skating, and they had a drugstore with a fountain. And I remember going into the fountain with my parents and getting a fountain Coke or an ice cream or something. It was really wonderful. On the way back, they were listening to the radio, and they all of a sudden got very sad. And I couldn't understand what was going on. And they said, Pearl Harbor was just bombed.
Wow.
And I thought, what? What's Pearl Harbor? You know, well, it took a few years before I realized what it meant. So that was my first conscious thing of something, let's say, international or political. We left Mescalero in 1947, moved to White River, Arizona, another Apache tribe. This is the White Mountain Apache tribe in eastern Arizona. And I graduated from eighth grade there. And fortuitously, my dad got a transfer to Phoenix. So I could go to a real high school, not ride a bus or go to boarding school or something like most of the other kids there did. And started high school in Phoenix, went there 3 years. My dad got a transfer to Gallup High School, or Gallup, New Mexico, and I went to Gallup High School, and that's where I actually graduated. Of course, I was going to go to the University of New Mexico. And again, my parents moved to, you guessed it, Minnesota. And so that led to my tenure, I guess you could call it, at the U of M for 2 degrees. I think I got a pretty good undergraduate education. I know I did a grade school and high school graduation or high school courses. I think overall, when I think about it, I was quite well prepared for university. I could go into a little detail about my sophomore blues and, you know, having to get serious about work and deciding, do I want to really do engineering? And I remember a discussion with you one time about playing basketball or being an engineer. It's happened to you. Ditto, it happened to me. And so I got serious, and I'm really glad I did. So I went to the University of Minnesota because it was the local state university. Mm-hmm. We arrived there in late August. I said, oh my gosh, they're probably starting university. I didn't even have a driver's license then. My mother drove me over to campus, walked up to the admissions office and said, I want to study engineering here. So, okay, let's see your high school transcript. Well, it's in Gallup, New Mexico. I'll have to write for it. And can you believe today these kids start thinking about school, what, in their sophomore year of high school or something? I mean, it's crazy. In those days, you could walk in, and if they had space, you got in. So that was a good experience for me. My favorite subject turned out to be soil mechanics and soils engineering from Dr. Miles Kirsten. And I later was his TA when I did my master's. And why did I go straight on? Well, I was 21 years old and I didn't want to go to work at a real job. And I thought, hey, I could just stay and be a TA, you know, continue my student life. And it worked out really well. I'm really glad I did that.
Yeah, I know that feeling.
I had a lot of fun. And I enjoyed being a TA too. That was one of the, you got to get the labs ready. You got to get the soils mixed and prepared for compaction and all that stuff. But I enjoyed doing that. I enjoyed working in the lab and I enjoyed the being a TA.
Mm-hmm. You keep in touch with many of your classmates or over the
I was thinking about that too a little bit because I did for several years. And then, you know, you get married or you move or things change. And I've lost track of some pretty good friends left over from there. And I'm sorry that I have. But that's life in a way. You know, it's kind of hard to keep in touch with everybody.
Yeah.
And I haven't tried Facebook or or LinkedIn or anything for any of those guys. They're my age or older, so they're probably pushing up daisies somewhere.
Well, hopefully not. So after you finished your master's at Minnesota, you worked for the Department of Water Resources on Orville Dam.
Yeah.
How was that? Describe that, your position, your responsibilities, and what it was like working on such a big project as a young engineer.
Well, I went to California because Department DWR was out recruiting, and my gosh, the salaries are about $100 a month more than what you got in Minnesota. And the other thing was the structural engineers are going to Boeing, but lasting a year and then coming back. And said, you know, that sounds really good. It'll be warmer than Minnesota. One of the things that I think you asked, what was the coldest day? Well, it was 31 or 33 below zero, and I rode my bike into campus because I didn't want to walk. And I got to say, it was cold.
That's a little after extra that, wind.
Yeah. Well, no, there's no wind at that temperature. It was dead. But, yeah. Oh, my gosh. But that's when I said, bike, you know, I got to go somewhere warmer.
Understandable.
So that was a very good job because a good introduction. I worked at inspection on access roads. So it was like built same job I had as a summer employee with the highway department. So, you know, that was easy. And then I got some work in tunnels. First, a 6-foot diameter water tunnel that was going to go through the embankment for a local water district. And one important lesson there is never build a 6-foot diameter tunnel. You know, I'm not real tall, as you know, and I could not walk in the middle of a 6-foot diameter tunnel. You would have never, your hard hat would be scraping the whole way. I mean, it was crazy.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I know why they did it, because it was the lowest cost, but make it 8 feet.
Yeah.
So what if you only need 3? You know, I mean, it's the construction was off. So there were some important lessons there. And then I worked on one of the large diversion tunnels. And that's where I lost my hearing because, you know, you didn't want to be a sissy college kid and wear any ear protection or something. Uh-huh. The drilling and the noise. This was a huge tunnel, 35 feet in diameter. And so grouting, I did all that stuff, grout curtains and all that sort of thing. It was really an interesting experience and wonderful. Really glad I did.
A lot of people from our generations lose their hearing at rock concerts, and you lost yours in a rock tunnel.
In a rock tunnel, exactly, yeah. Yeah, I'm always leaning on my granddaughters when they go to those concerts. I said, you know, remember granddad's got these hearing things. Please put some cotton in your ears or something. Yeah.
I'm sure they listen as much as we would have listened at the same age.
I know, exactly.
So you went to, after Oroville, you went to Sacramento State with a master's degree and had a professorship there. Was that common at the time to hire faculty without PhDs?
Well, the state colleges did. Most of my colleagues had a master's. And how I got that job was I was working at the soils lab, and we had a guy that filled in for me, and he had to get a PhD. He was teaching transportation over there in soils at Sac State, as we called it. And I was surprised too. I had the same question. He said, yeah, but there's a lot of pressure to get a PhD. This was 1962 or 3, 4, I guess. And so he left. And so I went and applied. I had a master's, PE by then. I went and applied at Sac State and I got the job. And it was a lot of work, but a lot of fun. Yeah. I really enjoyed the teaching. They had a very heavy teaching load. I think the first semester I taught 5 courses.
Wow.
Soil mechanics, highway engineering, and then three labs, concrete lab, soils lab, and surveying lab, if you can believe that.
Wow.
I was killed. I was dead by the time Christmas came. It was really, really long.
Yeah. So there was no expectation that you did research?
No, most of the people in the summer either worked for consultants or they may have done stuff, but there wasn't a real need to do that. And later, I think once they started with graduate degrees, especially master's degrees, they started offering that. And that was, you're a product of the University of California system. There were definite tiers between the university system and the state colleges.
Yeah.
And the state colleges were supposed to, crank out the practicing engineers and that sort of thing. And I think Sac State did a good job on that. I really do. One thing that surprised me was when Minnesota, they'd first started large computers, putting big computing systems in. And there was a note that came around that said, we've got a computer down here and you're not welcome to come down and bother us. My first class at Sac State, an average, very average student came in to me with a Fortran program on evaluating sieve analyses with a plot routine. Can you imagine? I mean, you got it on the big sheets of paper and everything.
Right, right.
My jaw dropped.
Yeah.
Because I was a slide rule engineer. We weren't taught the nomographs, we didn't.
Yeah.
Didn't do that sort of thing. I got to say, that was when it really scared me about the computer age. And that was 1963.
Yeah. Well, the Cal State system, they've got some of the campuses put out of some really good students. You recall some of the ones we've had from Cal Poly that have been quite good.
Oh, yeah.
Very well prepared.
Yeah, they really are. San Diego State, those schools have a very good engineering program, and probably through the master's at least. Yeah.
Sure. Yeah. So five courses per semester got old quickly, I suspect. And the pressure to go back and get a PhD, maybe that didn't feel like pressure to you after that kind of teaching load, but you did go back to Northwestern. How did you decide on Northwestern?
Well, that's a story that involves your major professor, H. Bolton Seed.
Okay.
He was a consultant to the Department of Water Resources. And Bill Hammond, my boss at the lab, and myself took 270A and part of 270B. Those were the courses that Harry taught, the first soil mechanics courses. And that'll get me on a whole nother story about taking that. Bill Kovacs was in that class, we later found out.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah. And so anyway, I contacted him and I said, I was thinking about doing it. And he said, well, you can come down. And he said, we'd like to have you be a student here. And yes, we do have a good PhD program, blah, blah, blah. And I talked to my boss at Sac State was Les Gabriel. He was doing his PhD in structures. And he was the one that told me, if you like teaching, he said, you're doing a good job here. We'd love to have you come back, but you got to get your union card. And naive me, I said, I didn't know Sac State had unions. Well, he said, no, you're a PhD dummy. Oh my gosh. So then he put me on to Northwestern. He said, everybody here is going to Berkeley. We need some new blood coming in here. Yeah. We can't be a little Berkeley. And I'd like to encourage you to consider going somewhere else. And this program at Northwestern looks pretty good. And he said, there's a guy named Bob Conner who's publishing a lot. And Bob Conner didn't have a very good reputation in the profession, it turns out, but that's a whole other story too. Later, so it turned out that I had a chance to go to Harvard, and I applied, and that's why I got out of my contract at Sac State. I should have taught the second year. And So I asked for relief because I wanted to attend this special program in soil mechanics that Professor Casagrande had at Harvard. And so on the way, stopped at Northwestern and interviewed Ray Kryzik, and I think he was the only one working there that day. It was a Saturday.
Okay.
And one of the grad students invited me to come home with them for the evening. And, you know, I got to know people, and it was a small program. And I thought, you know, I can do this. I could. My previous introduction to Berkeley was 35 students in Perry's class.
Yeah.
He had all the structures kids in there too. And so the place was packed. Yeah. And, you know, and I thought, yeah, that sounds like I need to go to a smaller program where I'll be happier. And after I went to MIT, when I was at Harvard, I went down and saw somebody at MIT that I knew. And that was a factory too.
Yeah. In those days. Yeah.
And so I'm really glad I went, and I'm glad Ray Kryzik was my my major professor. He was just an assistant professor then, just starting out, and nobody heard of him. And he had us start on writing proposals and getting papers and drafting them. And just, it was a great experience for me, just what I needed. And Chicago is not a bad place for engineers either, with all the foundations. And
sure.
It was, well, you know, you've been there, so
yeah,
worked there. So
fun place to live,
fun
too.
Fun place to live and fun place to work, yeah.
Yeah.
It was a good experience.
That's great. So what was the subject of your research? What did you work on?
It was a little bit, I wanted to do something in the lab, and we got some high pressure triaxial equipment. So I did some laboratory tests on clays. It took us about 2 years to make these samples on kaolin clays because they consolidate faster. And so I did tests up to 5,000 or 500 PSI. I don't know what that is in SI anymore. I used to know, but it extended the range of lateral pressures probably from 120 PSI up to 500. So it was a significant difference. And I got a lot of good information out of that and managed to publish a couple of papers from it. And it was certainly a good experience working on that.
Mm-hmm.
We had to build the lab. We had to do a lot of stuff. And I learned a lot about how do you do experiments? How do you design them? That was really a valuable experience, especially when I got to UW and we didn't have a lab class.
Yeah,
you know, I had to develop one, and so all that experience working with the machine shops and getting that stuff done, it really was a valuable experience.
Put you in a good position to torture our graduate students with that.
Yeah, I guess so. Yeah, that's a kind of a sore point with me. That boy, everybody wants to do it on the computer, and I'm thinking, you know, at least do one by hand.
Sure. Yeah.
And plot that up. So make sure, I don't know, there's just something about that. I'm sorry to be so old-fashioned, but
no, I'm right behind you there. You need to know which end of a wrench to grab, and you know, learn a little plumbing and a little electronics and data acquisition and all that sort of thing.
It's really valuable.
Yeah,
especially when it comes to interpreting test results later in practice.
Yeah.
Used to drum that into the students. They probably got tired of hearing it.
I think recognizing what you don't know from these tests as well as what you do know is important.
Well,
and the lab experience helps you understand that.
Fantastic. Absolutely important. Yeah.
Yeah. So after you finished at Northwestern, you took a position in at SGI, the Swedish Geotechnical Institute in Stockholm. How did that come about? And what did you... What'd you work on there?
Well, that was an interesting experience because I actually interviewed at Purdue for the job that I think Bill Kovacs got.
Oh.
And I was married at that time, and my wife did not want to go. She was a California gal. She didn't want to go to Indiana, and she was very, very upset about that possibility. At the same time, Ray Krizek had gone to Mexico for the international conference. It was Mexico City in 1960. That was 1969, so just before I graduated.
Okay.
And he had been on some kind of a tour with Bengt Brahms. And he said, you know, Bengt Brahms at the SGI can't get people there to do research.
Really?
Yeah. At that time, practice was booming and people were getting hired right away.
Yeah. Yeah.
And there was a real shortage of geotechs. And so he couldn't get people to go there and do any real research. And I thought, wow, that doesn't sound too bad. And George Osterberg, my other professor at Northwestern, was originally Swedish. Mm-hmm. He was born in this country, but yeah. He's Swedish. He spoke Swedish. And he said, that'd probably be a good thing for you. He said, Bengt's got a good program there. And Bengt had excellent credentials at that time. Had been mm-hmm. at Cornell and Shell Oil, and you know, he was a great guy, very well reputed. And I thought, okay, it's not NGI, but it'll be all right.
Yeah.
And NGI, it turned out, you had to bring your own money if you wanted to go to NGI, and I did investigate that.
Mm.
I thought, well, they offered me the equivalent of $500 a month, which is about double of what I was getting for my stipend at Northwestern. And by then I had a kid, and I'd go, oh my God. George told me, he said, you'd never live in stock. You can never live on $500 a month. Well, he was right, but.
Yeah. That was my next question. Was the cost of living difference there as great as it is?
Yeah, it was really a big deal.
Yeah.
And Bengt took pity on me a couple months later and raised me to $700 a month equivalent. And,
yeah.
Well, there's, you know, a lot of story. Actually, you know, if you were still coming off of being a student, it wasn't that much different. You had to watch your pennies.
Right. Yeah.
And it was a really good experience. My first job was to review the work that Sven Mahansbo had done on sand drains in Sweden. And they had a test field with actual field tests and piezometers and samples. And I redid, got some money from the Institute to redo some of those studies.
Okay.
And by then there'd been 13 or 14 years of experience. And pore pressures dissipated, or I guess to you, they go down this way and dissipated, and looked at some of the behavior and they had experiments with different spacing and different loading. And so there was a lot of information that came out of that. And I think it was wonderful, a wonderful experience to work on that.
So is that your first kind of introduction to soil improvement?
Yeah.
And that area?
That really did it, yeah. And, and in fact, involved the modern wick drain. Indirectly, a good friend of mine at the SGI invented it. Well, he invented the modern one with the plastic core, and then later a geotextile cover, and did a test, and you know, had a chance to look at some of that data and get involved in that, and you learned some real practical things about, for example, installing piezometers in soft clays. You know, it's pretty easy. You just push them down on the back of a truck, and it's not hard to push them very deep, 5-6 meters. And the ground temperature there is not the same as it is on the surface. It's not the same as in the lab. And so your calibration is very important.
Yeah.
So I learned to calibrate at ground temperature, mean annual temperature of the soil.
Yeah.
You wouldn't have thought that would influence things, but I can tell you visimetric readings are very different then.
Yeah, made a big difference.
Yeah, and some a few little lessons like that. I worked on the first lime columns. And that was a very interesting experience. That's, I won't go into all the details of that. The wick drains. I mentioned the sand drains that were very common in Sweden, and they didn't use the Chelmon paper drain that had been invented about the same time, 1936, because it's in the first international conference. He talks about it. Mm-hmm. And what? Why wasn't it ever used? George Osterberg told us about that as an alternate to sand drains. And so I started asking around. And the reason sand drains or wick drains were never used was because the insulation equipment was owned by the road board and available rent-free to contractors. Whereas Walter Chelmon, he tried to get the Swedish government to patent it patent it for him, and they said we don't hold patents, and so he sold his patent to the Pierre Franchi, the Franchi Foundation company in Belgium, and of course Franchi wants to get royalties anytime you use it. Worked in Europe and Japan, South America, and everything, never in Sweden. Because really? It couldn't compete with the highway department's equipment.
Yeah.
That's amazing. Yeah. That's absolutely. When I heard that story, prophet hath no honor in his own country.
That's right.
Yeah.
It's really that's interesting.
Yeah. That was a great experience, I got to say, working at the SGI.
When was that around the time you started getting involved with earth reinforcement and geosynthetics and that sort of thing?
Yeah, that happened because, again, this guy that invented developed the Chelmon paper drain to the modern wick drain is also started working with geosynthetics. And at that time, There were, I think, only one or two manufacturers of this fabric that they were selling for road reinforcement.
Okay.
And, we did some lab tests and so on. And I said, I just don't think this stuff's ever going to reinforce anything. But there are some other benefits from installation. And so, I think a lot of that, I don't know what the heck I was doing, frankly, working with geosynthetics in those days. But slowly, over the years, you learn things, you talk to different people at conferences, and after a while, some stuff begins to make sense. Mm-hmm. We made model tests about 4 feet high, I think they were, a meter net, 20 or so, with strips of this stuff. With the wood planks, because we didn't have any money for concrete facing, modeling reinforced earth.
Mm-hmm.
And put load on it to get it to move, because the thing wouldn't move, just sitting there. Put load on it with airbags and so on, and it would move and move and move like hell, but it never fell down. You talk about deformation tolerable. Wow.
Yeah.
Now, you'd never build a wall like that. You don't want to have the darn thing blowing out, but you learn a few things from those kinds of experiments.
Yeah.
Some of them are mistakes and, you've done research, so you know.
No, it must have been interesting to be involved kind of at the beginning of that, the development and use of that technology, and to have seen it really over its entire lifetime to date, at least.
Yeah. Yeah. It was, fortuitous, a chance to work with those materials and oh, sorry. Ah, sorry. I should have turned my phone on. Sorry. I don't know what that is. So anyway, what was I, my thought? Oh, I have to tell you a little story about H. Bolton and geosynthetics.
Okay.
In about 83 or 84, he gave some lectures at Purdue. And unfortunately, I was gone. And so I came back, and Jean-Louis Chameau was my young colleague there at that time. And he said, we had a nice conversation with Professor Seed, and somebody asked him about the future of geosynthetics or geotextiles or what do you want to call them, engineering fabrics. And he said, nah, it'll never go anywhere. Yeah. No, wait, you're wasting your time. Oh, gosh. I thought, you know, if God tells you don't use this, better not, I better not. But by then I was hooked.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I think time has proven that.
I really enjoy that.
No, it's every time when I drive home from campus here, I'll be going by a big wall that's going in on one of the local highways. So
it's routine now. It's
routine. Absolutely.
Yeah. I mean, that's in a working person's lifetime that those developments had occurred. It's really quite remarkable, I think. Yeah. And that's true a lot of soil improvement technologies. You know, the contractors have been fantastic. Developing stone columns and some of those.
Yeah, that's where the innovation comes in that area is from the contractors, not the kind of historical process of research to implementation.
Right. Yeah, exactly.
That it works and then figure out why later.
Yeah. Yeah, if I was starting over in my career, I would have looked more careful. I would look more carefully at working for a contractor.
Yeah,
I know the hours are terrible, and it's terrible to have a family and all that other stuff. But the benefits of being in there with a good contractor, even if it's just putting in tiebacks or you know whatever they do, driving piles, the chances of getting involved in really fundamental developments in our field are wonderful. There.
Yeah, I think you're right. So after. After Sweden, well, talk a little bit about living in Sweden versus here. That must have been an interesting transition, just culturally and socially.
It was quite a change. It's a wonderful country in a lot of ways. We've already talked a little bit about the expenses, how expensive it is. But one of the reasons it's expensive is taxes are high.
Yeah.
And one of the reasons taxes are high is because the services are really great.
Yeah.
Medical, anything medical is quote free. I mean, it's very near taxes.
Right.
Public transportation is very good. Just it's a wonderful place to live if you don't have any money. Culturally, well, that's a big city, Stockholm. And so it was wonderful. It's like being in Chicago. I could go to the symphony. I could go to the opera. I could go all this stuff. And it wasn't outrageously expensive like the modern entertainment is here.
Yeah. But,
and then the other thing is, and this probably has to be, these stories have to be left to over a few beers or something, because I also went through a divorce there. And I got to say, if you're going to be divorced, a single guy in a place, Sweden in the early 70s was a wonderful place to be. Swedish women, ooh la la.
Okay.
I mean, and I'll just leave it at that.
Yeah, I think you better. So you left all of that. Eventually, and went to Purdue. Talk about being an assistant professor there at Purdue in that group. You had some senior, very strong senior faculty. What made Purdue so great as it was at that time?
That's an interesting question, because Bill Kovacs and I talked about that at one time. We said, these full professors fought like cats and dogs. It was a terrible faculty meetings, our group meeting. I mean, it was just a very unpleasant place in a lot of ways. People were passing notes to each other because they couldn't go in and talk to them. I mean, you know, it was a lot of stuff like that. There were factions, and oh, it was awful. And I talked to Bill, and I said, you know, why are we so well reputed when we have a terrible internal culture?
Yeah.
And we finally figured out it was because some of the full guy, the guys, the big names there were very, very good. And that rubbed off on us. Yeah. You know, if I went somewhere and Professor Leonard's, Professor Haar, Professor Lovell. Oh, yeah. Right. Yeah. And I'd bask in their glory. Even if they didn't enjoy each other's glory. I mean, it was a funny experience.
Yeah, that's too
culturally
bad.
It's Indiana. I won't say any more of that than that, except it's a very conservative area. Probably the biggest change, it's a good place to start a career because there's minimum distractions. oh my gosh, there's this great concert right now. I better go tonight, you know, instead of working. And so I thought after I was there a few years and kind of got acclimated, that it's really a good place for a young person to start. They know you at TRB, loved TRB, Purdue loved TRB for a lot of reasons. Any big conference I went to, ASCE or go to some committee, introduce yourself, and people would not take notice. Yeah. And Bill found the same experience there. It's a great place to work.
Well, there are a lot of prominent people in the profession that got their starts there.
That's right. Yeah.
Moved on to other places.
Yeah. And that I could have probably stayed there. After a sabbatical in Italy, I realized the sun didn't rise and set on Purdue. Yeah. There's some other views of the world of soil mechanics and foundation engineering. And that's one reason I made this switch after 15 years to come to UW.
Well, sometimes it's good to get away and get a different perspective on the place where you are. It was good for me to get away from Berkeley.
Yeah.
And,
different challenges and different people. That's always a benefit.
Yeah.
So my main incentive for coming to UW was because of Colin Brown.
Yeah.
Whom you know, right. And I don't know if we have time to go into the story of how I got to know him, but I was his TA at Minnesota for the soil mechanics course, first graduate course in soil mechanics that was taught the winter quarter at Minnesota. And I was a TA that year, my beginning year in grad school. And Miles Kirsten said, well, don't worry. I said, look, I'm just taking the course. He said, do your homework. I'll grade yours and we'll use that as the guide for the rest. And after about the second or third assignment, he said, Bob, we can't use yours as a guide. It has too many mistakes. So let's use this fellow Brown's examples, because he's really good.
Yeah.
You know, later, he was at Berkeley when I was at Sac State, and we ran into each other at an ACI conference in Berkeley. I took undergraduate lab class down for an ACI meeting, and, you know, some things like that. And there was Colin Brown, and we had a chat. And then one thing led to another. We kept in contact. You'd see each other at conferences and so on. And
yeah,
one of the times that I ran into him, he said, you know, there might be an opportunity at Washington. Boy, chance to do something really different with the different people. And then I met you at U-Sugar and TRB, that program that they had for the Drilled Shaft Contractors Association.
All three of those places we met.
You really interested me because you were so enthusiastic about things. And then also, it was kind of a sad story. You and Sunnermal were the only guys doing anything in geo. You had a complete program, and you're supposed to get research and get new publishing. Boy, that's a terrible situation. I was very sympathetic.
Yeah. Well, you kind of saved my career by coming, because I was about to bail out.
Were you? Yeah, I can imagine. The pressure is horrible, and you teaching, and you want to do a good job at it.
Yeah, well, things really turned around when you came.
And well, thanks.
No question about that. You have spent a lot of time working in other countries, particularly earlier in your career when you were at Purdue. I mentioned some of them earlier. You've done some of that work at research institutes, and then some of it with consulting firms. Talk a little bit about how those came about and some of the people that you got to work with there.
Well, I guess the first time was I spent a summer at the National Research Council of Canada, NRC Canada. And at that time, Carl Crawford was there. There were Mike Bozos. There were some really outstanding researchers there, Bill Eden. And I went there and spent the summer doing cone tests on a piezo cone, or actually it was just a regular cone, a Dutch cone interferometer, in real soft clays. And I think that stuff, it was never published. I never got around to writing it up, which was bad. But I really learned a lot from that. I learned other things about doing penetration tests with a piezo cone and some things like that. It was really a good experience. And getting to know people like Mike Bozizuk and Carl Crawford, Bill Eden, those fellows they had done some wonderful work on soft clays. And because most of my experience in Sweden was with soft clays, it was like heaven working there. And Ottawa is not a bad place in the summer. And you could go up to Montreal and for the weekend, and there was some nice things there. It really was fun. So that was a really good experience. The opportunities in France and Italy came about because of a sabbatical that I finally had. I've been at Purdue 11 years, so it was time for a change. Mm-hmm. And it was either that or I was gonna go somewhere else. I was kind of fed up and with the guys always fighting and everything. And I thought, I don't need this. And I was working more and more at home and not taking part in campus life, and sort of like your queue of students outside of my office. That's the way I felt about Purdue, that I didn't really enjoy going in. I'm just teaching my class and then going home. And I thought that's not a way to do it. So what was I going to say about that? It was something about the, it was going on the sabbatical. I knew some people in Europe at that time. I'd met them at conferences, I wrote to Francois Schlosser, who was the professor at EMPC, the École Nationale de Pont-Saint-Chaussée, and they had a research group there. A little place outside of Paris, but the EMPC is right downtown, three blocks from the Louvre. Mm. So it's really a wonderful location. And so we went there for the summer. Francois didn't have money for where you could supplement the the sabbatical salary,
right,
which was used a lot for expenses at home. I mean, mm-hmm. keeping the house and
sure, yeah.
You know, so you can imagine, you know, and then I went to Italy at Studio Geotechnical because Mike Amelkowski, I'd run into him at conferences, and I just wrote him as I think I'd written 8 people in France, and he was the 9th, or 7 people, and he was okay. the 8th, just by accident. And he said, sure, come on down. We'll pay you 3,000 lira a month. So, okay, I have no idea how much that was. It turned out to be not bad. It turned out the dollar was way up in the early 60s, or 64. So it was not bad. And both of us, both my wife and I, we loved Italy. She wanted to go to France because she was studying French. That was fine. Got a chance to go to Italy, and she had a hard time adjusting, and later just fell in love with the place. She wanted to stay.
So were you in Torino then?
No, we were actually in Milano, because
okay.
his company is in Milano. And so okay. I think on Tuesdays he didn't have any more classes, so Monday evening he would leave. You know, it's one of those kind of things. He was,
yeah.
he was at the studio about 3 days a week.
Okay.
And then we had a full staff of about 70 or 80 people. There was a big yeah. geotech firm. Yeah. And they did a lot of work all over the world. That was it was interesting because Francois had my job. I worked on there was some reinforced earth structures in Queensland, Australia.
Mm.
And that's worth a whole half hour of stories of how, yeah. what was involved there. And the same thing in Italy. I had some great jobs on foundations in Rome, foundations in Iraq for power plants.
Wow.
Got involved in the Iran war back in that time of the century. And so and some of that stuff was really very, very interesting. A tunnel down a big railroad tunnel in eastern Italy, kind of southeast of Italy, that had run into a fault or something, and it caused about a 2.5 or 3 foot drop in a farmer's yard up
oh, really?
The top of the tunnel.
Okay.
And, you know, you look at the scale, and Jesus, you know, it's 50 meters up there. How did that happen? So there's something in those very stiff clays. It was a soft ground tunnel.
Yeah.
And later I talked to some colleagues. I said, what happened to that job? And he said, oh, they just went ahead and finished it. Huh? You know, and here the contractor, the Italian contractors are fantastic. The first thing they do, okay, stop the job. Let's find out what's wrong. And they hire some professors. There was a professor of rock mechanics over at Torino, but also did a lot of numerical stuff. So he was involved, and we were, Studio Geotechnical is involved. And you know, I said, boy, this is a great job, but you know, it's a research project.
Yeah.
Stiff fissured clays. You know, why does this happen? How does it propagate up there? And stress distribution. You know, you think about all those things.
Yeah.
And finally, I found he said, oh, they just got on with it. I said, Italian contractors don't want to sit around. And I found that in many, many jobs, that you know, if there's a problem, they'll study it and they'll think about it maybe a week or two.
Yeah.
And if it's not answered, just get the damn thing done.
Make a decision.
That's happened in Taiwan. A dam in Colombia, the same thing.
Yeah.
Whereas you can imagine the U.S. Oh my God, we got to study this. We got to get lawyers involved, and the French are just as silly in a different way, and the Germans. Oh my gosh, I can tell you the Italians have stories talking about contractors, those guys, if they're German or whatever. Italian contractors, you know, they get the job done. I really hand it to them. I think if you ever are working on a job and you got a choice between the Italian or whatever it is, and I don't care where it is, choose the Italian contractors.
Okay, there you go.
Because you're going to finish it.
endorsed by Bob Holtz.
Yeah, absolutely.
So while you were at Purdue, you already mentioned Bill Kovacs, and I know that you and Bill had a lifelong friendship. Talk a little bit about Bill and the process by which the two of you had the idea to write your textbook, and then how you went about doing it. How'd you split up the work? And it's an important textbook and reference book for the geotechnical profession. I'm sure people would like to hear about this.
Well, it was kind of interesting because actually we were partnering with a guy that wrote a lot of books. Oh my gosh, the name slipped my mind. He was at Bradley University. I'm sure if I said his name, you'd remember. I'm sorry.
Not Braja Das?
No, not Das.
He's written a lot of books.
Yeah, he's written a lot of books. No, this guy was a professor. He was actually from Bradley, which is a private school. And he and his wife published a lot of books. Doesn't matter. He was working on a undergraduate soil mechanics book, and Bill got excited about having him. And he and his wife came down, and they were an elderly couple that didn't have children. And the Kovacs, he had five kids then, I think, or four. And you go to dinner with them, it is chaos, as you can imagine. All these little kids, and they're all punning. And like Bill's a punter, a very punny guy. He said, he came back to me the next day, and he said, you know, I think it's not going to work. This guy, oh, geez. As soon as we finish here, I'm going to remember his name. He said, I don't think we can work together. And I already had reviewed a couple of chapters of them, and they were awful. The consolidation chapter he talked about, well, eventually consolidation stops. Have you ever heard of secondary, young man? Old man. And I remember there was a student. He was actually Bill Lovell's son. Doug Lovell was one of the brightest students that we had in our program at that time. He knew more. He was a very, very smart guy, and he had done a lot of reading, even though he was just a senior then. He wasn't even a grad student. And I remember him meeting Venk Fellanius one time. Venk used to come down every once a year, come through there and give us a lecture. And so we could go out to eat and talk with Milton and so on. He was a lot of fun. And he said, who is that young man, Lovell? I said, yeah, his dad's a professor here. And he said, that young man, he's obviously a PhD student. I said, no, he's senior. He said, that young man knows more about piles than most engineers and professors.
Wow.
And Doug read this chapter, and he said, did you write this? And I said, no, but I'd like your honest opinion. He said, well, whoever it is should go back and read Leonard's chapter 2, Taylor's chapter 9, and start over.
Yeah.
And I told Bill this, and I said, you know, that guy, he's got different standards than we do.
Yeah.
We can't put stuff out there just to get it out. And he had a book contract with McGraw-Hill because he sold a lot of books, mainly on foundations. But that's what got us started. And I said, you know, we've already written four or five chapters, let's just keep doing it and not use what this guy had given us the drafts. And So that's how we got started. We didn't, you know, we didn't really split up the work and such, except there were certain chapters I was interested in. I wanted to do chapter four on clay mineralogy because I'd studied that as a grad student. And both of us did chapter five. And I remember very well at the end of the, after we'd published, Bill was looking for a job. He had big family and their salaries were crappy. And he actually interviewed at Duke. And I remember the chair of the department at Duke University called me and he said, you know, your colleague Kovacs, I see he's the second author. And I said, well, let me take a look. And I looked at the table of contents. And well, Bill and I did that. I wrote this one. He wrote that. We're the primary author, if you will. I said, it came out virtually 50-50. And Bill's great contribution was the jokes. I think there are only two of them in there.
It's the first textbook I ever encountered with jokes in it.
Well, there are two of them that are mine. That was the bulldozer and Milt Haar.
Okay.
Yeah, because Milt had told me, he said, oh, I've been trying to get capillarity into my... into my book somewhere, and he's written what, four or five books, and never could figure out how to get anything on capillary. He said, I said, why? He said, I wanted to talk about Giuseppe Meniscus. And I said, oh, perfect. So we were just starting chapter six then on capillarity and, you know, static water, and then went. So I figured out where it would go after Jeff, you know, Meniscus. There's another part of that story that's funny, too. A lot of people noticed that it was a joke. The review in Geotechnique by a guy at another soil mechanics guy, I should remember his name. He said, and including the reference to the historical reference to Giacomo Meniscus. Milt always said, why'd you change Giacomo? And I said, oh, I just thought it sounded better than Giuseppe.
Yeah.
And then the French guy, Jean Le Pleur, when he translated into French, he took out all the jokes.
Oh, he did, huh?
Yeah.
Oh.
And Bill and I were crushed. I mean,
he didn't replace them with French jokes?
No.
No.
And I thought, look, the Montreal kids, they're bilingual and they get it both ways, or they don't get the joke, which about half the Americans don't either, or more.
Yeah.
So, you know, I mean, come on.
So how many jokes are in there?
Did you? Oh, I don't
count.
No, I never counted. No.
Oh, okay.
Well, and I'm not sure they're jokes in the case. Some of them are amusing. Well, I don't know. Maybe they aren't amusing. But.
Well, using that term broadly, but they're there's unusual, kind of a welcome addition, I think, when a lot of people went through it.
Well, I wish that I could answer the question of how many. I've never sat down and counted them.
Yeah.
But who is it? I think it might have been Joe Haggerty at Louisville told me one time, I think he would, or maybe his other colleague there, I can't remember, one of those two guys, use that as a final, as an exam question, extra credit, how many jokes are in Holtz and Kovacs?
Okay.
And I said, and you got an answer? How many, please?
Yeah.
He said, oh, I always return the finals. I don't remember what the guy said.
Well, Bill was a character.
He really was.
On one of his visits to Seattle, I asked him to sign my copy of his book, and his inscription was, you know, "Dear Steve, don't believe everything you read." Geo Kovacs.
Yeah, I have used that phrase many, many times.
Yeah.
And most of the time, people are pleased. There, one time, there was this young man from RPI, and he came at a I think it was at Chi Epsilon or something I was working
okay.
on. He came down with his book and he wanted me to sign that. And I said, here, you know, don't believe everything you read. And he was crushed.
Oh,
I don't know what he wanted me to write. You know, good luck in your academic or geotechnical career. Or I don't know. Yeah, he wasn't smiling. Most people think that's really funny.
Yeah.
Love it. Yeah. Because, yeah, but he's right. Bill's absolutely right.
Yeah.
Don't believe everything you read.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's a great guy. I miss him a lot. I really do.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, you guys had a special bond there.
Yeah.
So you came to Seattle from a smaller town to a bigger town and a new group of students, new group of colleagues, smaller group, but we, you know, with only three of us, we didn't have factions.
Yeah, so that's right.
That was
I loved it.
How did you find that transition?
Well, culturally, it was fantastic. My wife and I were talking about this the other day. So we used to spend a lot of money going out to eat. Mm-hmm. there were places that were open after we'd get out of the Seattle Symphony or an opera or something. It was wonderful.
Yeah.
And you know, we finally, after about 6 months, we said, you know, we're spending an awful lot of money going out. Well, maybe we should not go out every night or every other night. Yeah, that was great. We loved walking to the Husky games and occasionally going down to the Mariners. They were still playing in the Dome in those days. And
yeah.
I remember who I talked to. It might have been Joe Mahoney or somebody said, don't even think about trying to get Seahawks tickets because, you know, you had a wait list a mile long. In those days, they were really popular.
Yeah.
So, but the cultural life we really enjoyed.
Yeah.
And although, I got to say it was a lot of work. As you know, we taught a lot.
Yeah.
We taught a lot of, we had a lot of courses that we were responsible for in a small program. I think we did a very creditable job when I look back on it.
I said I would tend to agree with you.
Yeah, well,
since
one thing I learned from you was spend time with the students and get to know them.
Yeah.
And I think that is really important. Your former department, that was not true. You had to kind of take a number and hope that they were in, or that they could see you and that they had time. And I think that attention to our students is one of our real strengths. And I hope the two new guys keep that same attitude.
I've always felt it was important and it was a strength, and students have said that to us.
Oh, good.
It's been unfortunate with COVID because nobody's around, and they had, I got a little taste of one quarter's worth of teaching two classes online. And
I remember that.
Boy, I didn't like it very much. It kind of reinforced my decision to retire when I did.
But I remember you telling me that. And
following year, it was all online. And talking to Pedro and the others, it's kind of that camaraderie that we kind of work to establish that goes away quickly when people aren't with each other.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
But I think it's coming back now.
Oh, good. I hope so, because I think that was a real strength of our group.
Yeah. They've been doing geo beers, and I was out of town for the last couple of them, but I'm looking forward to showing up, and no one will know who I am, but
they'll know
a lot of beers.
Because I was thinking I ought to show up too for one or two of those. I think they're really
okay. Cool. Well, we can do it together.
We'll have to do it. Yeah. Yeah. I don't know if I'm still on their list, but I hope so.
So you retired in 2008. How have you been spending your time since then?
Well, the first 5 years, I had one of those 5-year retirement things, which I really enjoyed. I think that was a perfect way, you know, you're working hard here and then you'd go down to halftime and then, and then finally they say, well, your services are no longer needed. Thanks very much. And I think it's worked out really well. Not worrying about the academic year, not worrying. Well, you know, you're retired, so you don't have to worry. Oh my gosh, it's finals week, or I can't be gone that day because of so and so. That really was wonderful, I think, for me. I really have enjoyed that. That left me time to work on the Geo-Institute stuff, especially the international side of it. And just still participate at the local group as much as I can. They haven't met very much either, but I try to attend their meetings and webinars and stuff. And I don't do a real faithful job like I used to, but I still try to do that.
I'm looking forward to the in-person meetings starting up again.
Yeah, that'll be really good. Yeah. Well, and then the other thing about being retired is I'm not nearly, and maybe that's getting older, not being retired, I'm not nearly as efficient as I used to be. I get up and I have a cup of tea and read something or listen to the radio, and then pretty soon it's kind of late and I better get dressed, and crickets, oh, you got to walk the dog, and you know, boy, it's already noon. What do we?
What happened?
I'd like to do more consulting than I have. I haven't had the phone ringing off the hook with jobs. And on the other hand, I think maybe that's just as well. I probably could do it, but
if you're enjoying what you're doing, and the lifestyle you have. I know you're up in Port Townsend looking out over the bay and near the Strait of Juan de Fuca. It's a gorgeous place there.
Not too bad. Unfortunately, the mountains are socked in now and I can't show you the.
Yeah, there's actually sunshine here. So it's a good day.
Maybe we'll get a sunbreak here. I don't know.
So you mentioned ASCE in the international work that you're doing. You've had a long relationship with ASCE over the years and had many, responsible positions from editing the journal to being president of the Geo Institute to now your current involvement. Can you describe how you got involved with ASCE initially and how it's benefited you as a professional?
Well, I think I've gotten involved. I'm not even sure that they had a student chapter at Minnesota. I don't recall that. But when I went to Sac State, by then I must have already joined as a full member, not as a student member, but a full member. And I remember the Sacramento section had noon meetings. And so my boss and the dean at that time, who was also a civil engineer, said, oh, we're going down to section lunch. You want to come along? And I said, sure. And I think that got me started in it because they'd have a technical program. And you're back in the office at about 1:30. And so it was a very nice once a month, kind of got habit of doing that. And I think that was probably the start of it, was that.
Yeah.
And certainly at Purdue, it was a lot more emphasized, I guess, when you were a professor there to be involved with a branch of the Indiana section there.
Yeah.
The Lafayette branch, which was really the Purdue branch. And TRB, the same thing. I remember talking to my department chair at that time, and I said, how did you get to be well known in your profession? He said, well, you work on a committee and make a difference. And he said, I said, well, how do you get on a committee. So you usually ask, pick a subject, and ding, 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 ding. Oh, yeah. And I think that really helped launch my career. I enjoyed that camaraderie that you get from meeting colleagues and different people at conferences and committee meetings. We didn't do the phone conferences. We didn't have all that stuff. So you actually had to physically go to these meetings and TRB and some of those and the ASCE conferences. And that kind of got me started. I was invited by, I think it was actually Ray Kreisick called me and said, we want to ask you if you want to be on the executive committee of the division. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, sure. And he said, well, a junior member, you get to take notes and, you know, do all this stuff. I'm like, okay, I'll be happy to do that. Well, that was the time they were considering starting the Institute.
Yeah.
And so then I got in there with Priscilla Nelson, and we did all set up the committee structure, sort of TRB-like, but different. We didn't like that friends of the committee and all that stuff. So,
right.
Why don't we have any? We don't need any restrictions, right? So, and control group members, which were part of the old technical committee structure in ASCE, and a lot of that stuff was, I don't know, we didn't like that. Let's get as many people we can who are going to work and be interested in the committee. So that's the way we set up the committee structure. We picked a couple of new subjects, and other than that, every committee, we wanted to completely revise the committee structure. Oh, we're important. Well, why are shallow foundations different than deep foundation? Oh, we're separate because we do. Yeah. So,
yeah.
And same thing with grouting. Why is grouting not in the soil improvement? Oh, because the grouters, we're different.
Yeah. Yeah.
It was fun. You got to learn some. When the GI first started, I learned a lot about ASCE internal politics. And like most large organizations, it's not pretty. It's, you know, I think they do a lot of silly things. And a lot of it is driven, and I think this is a fault of the human interactions, that it's a lot of it's driven by money. And a lot of our problems were we had this budget model that we had to follow. Well, what they finally figured out, you've got $750,000 to start. That's your seed money. And you got to pay all your staff and do all this other stuff with that.
Right.
Oh, I wish you'd told us that at the beginning instead of trying to fight and fudge and do stuff. Oh, it was awful. But we persisted, and I think it's been successful. It's been that's been a real pleasure to see that how well the GI has done over the years.
Yeah,
we're one of the star divisions, I guess you could say, of ASCE.
It feels like it. Yeah, it does. Particularly recently, with all of the interactions that Brad and others have established, things like this, I think. Are fantastic.
Yeah, I think it's been a great success. I'm rather proud of that little bit at the beginning.
That's an important contribution. So you've over the course of your career delivered many FHWA, NHI geotechnical workshops, geosynthetics workshops. How has that been different than educating people that way in those kinds of formats than teaching university students?
Well, especially there's a huge difference between teaching professionals and teaching undergraduates. Mm-hmm. And that's because about half or two thirds of the people, they don't want to be in that class anyway.
Yeah.
So that's really not a lot of fun. With grad students, it's a little different.
Sure.
But you still have people that, I'm sorry I put my phone away, but, you know, do that instead of taking notes and things like that. But not as much. And But I got to say, with the professionals, you usually get very good attention. First, they're only there for 2 or 3 days.
Right.
They're being paid to be there. They must believe, because they signed up for your course, that they want that information. And I've always enjoyed doing those courses. I don't think Barry and I have ever run into one group that wasn't real enthusiastic or wanted to be there. And sometimes there are people there that you kind of wonder why they're there, drillers or something like that. But that's okay. You know, yeah. I enjoy going over and talking to them about their problems. And you learn enormous amount from guys, the Kansas Highway Department worrying about runoff, and
sure, yeah,
the guys in Kentucky. You know, it's just, that's been a real pleasure to teach those fellows.
Yeah, that's great.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun.
So you've been around the world over the course of your career.
Oh my gosh, yeah.
I don't know anybody who's traveled as much as you or so clearly enjoys their travels and the people that they've met. What are some of your favorite places, or most memorable trips, best food you've had, worst food you've had?
Well, Sweden was pretty special, because I actually lived there and got to know a little bit about the society and the system. I'd say living in France probably had the best food overall, although Italy is really, really good.
Yeah.
You know, some just little corner places in a kind of a nondescript suburb.
Sure.
And
yeah.
You almost can't believe the quality of the food.
Mm-hmm.
It's not a pizza place. I mean, it's,
yeah.
You know, they have antipasto, they have all this other stuff, and the primo and the segundo and the dessert, and it's just wonderful.
Yeah.
I mean, you almost can't believe it. And it's usually very relatively inexpensive, or at least it was
right.
In those days,
yeah.
For us. I guess that's one. Japan I enjoyed a lot. And I guess some of the food there, it's a little strange, but there were some things that we had there that I make myself today.
Yeah.
There's certain dishes that are pretty easy to do, spinach with soy sauce and sesame seeds. I mean, it's wonderful, you know.
Yeah.
There's some things like that. So I guess, I don't know about worse food, other than I thought the food in Sweden was pretty bad, unless you're willing to spend a lot of money in restaurants.
No.
Except the pizzerias were just coming in.
Mm.
And the only foreign food was Chinese.
Okay.
And the same thing in Italy, it's hard to find a different ethnic group. Now, yeah. That may have changed.
Yeah,
but
I think it has. So you didn't get any lutefisk in Sweden, or is that just a dish?
I did a couple of times in Norway, and
they
would also have it in Sweden. And one of the problems with lutefisk, at least what was sold in Minnesota, it was never washed enough to get the lye out. If you could, you got to get that preservative out of the fish. And once you get that out, it still isn't, it isn't up to our salmon here.
No, that's for sure. Far from it.
Yeah.
The only benefit was, when I've had it, at least they served it with beer. And
a lot
of beer.
That helps.
Yeah. Swallow.
Or schnapps, the straight alcohol. That helps a lot of food go down.
So you've had, over the course of your career, you've really made tremendous contributions in the education area with your textbook, which is, and the second edition, which I should have mentioned also, that was done here. in Seattle. All of the geosynthetics books, reports, the short courses that you've done, it's really a tremendous contribution towards education of the profession. You've also had many contributions in research and in your professional service through ASCE and other organizations. What do you consider to be your most significant? What are you most proud of looking back?
Well, clearly the textbooks, both first and second. The fact that A, we finished the first edition, and B, that it only took us 30 years to do the second. And by the way, how's your second edition coming?
it's getting close. You could say you told me that 10 years ago, but it's all written. There's chapters reviewed. It's going to get out there pretty soon.
Oh, good. I'm glad to hear that, because I guess I should have teased you about that a little more, but I know how hard it is to
get. Yeah, it's a glass houses kind of thing.
Yeah.
Right? For both of us.
Really? Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So I guess that what the other part of your question had to do with research contribution or teaching contributions. Yeah. I think that's probably
teaching, I think, is pretty well recognized and established from the research. What do you think is the most significant?
Well, I think probably the overall work on geosynthetics and understanding the practical implications and applications of many of the, I mean, there's an enormous variety of materials. It's probably many more materials than, for example, concrete. Okay, you can vary the strength, but what else, you know? It's hard to vary the modulus and some other things without adding steel or fibers or something. So as far as the variety of materials that are possible, but that's also, I think, a challenge on which products to use. Mm-hmm. And one of the disadvantages of the geosynthetics profession, I guess, is, if I call it a profession, is that it's involved a lot of commercial interests that don't exist in the steel and concrete industry. Mm-hmm. So that kind of muddies the water in a way. Use my product because it's the best, right, and mine's the cheapest, and so on. In a way, that's kind of a disadvantage. But I think overall, you know, when I go to conferences and I start to see how mature geosynthetics are, mm-hmm, especially at international conferences, and I see a lot of stuff that, it's interesting, but, you know, Barry Christopher and I did that in 1983 or 1987, or, you know, wait a minute.
Yeah.
So a lot of it is rediscovering the wheel or refining constants, as my colleague Mel Barr used to say.
So do you think the kind of the economics of the industry has spurred innovation?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, it certainly spurred a lot of people to try them. I don't know about innovation as much. I guess that it has. I think, they've really have made enormous contributions, even though it's self-serving, if you will.
Sure. Yeah. You
know, to a lot of research and their work in the geosynthetics committees and so on, I think is valuable.
So you've seen over the last 40 or 50 years a lot of changes in the geotechnical profession.
Yeah.
What do you think, or what do you view as some of the most significant, and where do you see things going in the future?
Well, certainly the use of the digital computer has been an enormous breakthrough in our profession, in geotech, in civil and in geotech. It has a danger of kind of overwhelming practice, that we I think, tend to rely on computer solutions instead of a lot of common sense or back of the envelope calculations. And of course, you know, when I talked to our colleague Pedro Arduino about that, he said, oh, you always check it. Or you all, you know, and yeah, be careful about using correlations. He knows that.
Yeah.
I'm not sure the average Joe engineer out there that has this Plaxis or whatever else, it's there, how wonderful they think they're getting results.
Yeah.
And then you find they're correlating with an SPT or
right.
pulling numbers out of the air. I think, what? And no one ever checks. I mean, a lot of people don't check, and they tend to believe the computer. Now, of course, it makes a lot of work for those of us that are working for attorneys. And I've had a lot of jobs, consulting jobs, because of that.
Yeah.
But it bothers me that the profession has relied so much on that. I think we've forgotten the importance of getting properties. How many consulting firms now have a lab?
Right.
You know, and so, yeah, I think that's a real worry for our profession. But I don't know if it's endemic to geotech. I hope that the pendulum swings back to a little more in the middle. One of the big differences I've noticed really in the profession is how little interaction we have with practice.
Yeah.
And I mean, the academic side of things.
Yeah.
Yeah, historically, you know, when I started, my gosh, you know, Illinois and MIT and all those guys were they had consulting companies, basically.
Yeah. Yeah.
And even Purdue did a little of that, although I was told, we're not going to be Illinois. When
right.
I went there, that was one of the things that they said. But, you know, Jerry and Milt did a lot of consulting, but they always met their classes.
Yeah.
And they were Monday, Wednesday, Friday, or Tuesday, Thursday, or whatever it was. Not like Illinois, where they only had classes on Saturday and their graduate classes and stuff. So, but I'd like to see more interaction with between the profession. I don't know if it's a matter of the young guys getting jobs with consultants in the summer. I mean, that used to be valued.
You know? Yeah, I'm sure it did. I recognize that it did. It's tough to square that with the demands on young faculty now just to get tenured. And
that's right.
And the way, you know, the way things are counted. You know, I don't know if I would survive as an assistant professor these days. It's a different world than even I kind of grew up in the academic sector.
Yeah. I know I wouldn't survive. I know I could never get tenure.
Yeah.
I'd have to go to Sac State and teach all the time.
Well, and then you could work for a consulting firm
in
the summers it's kind of the older model,
right.
But the universities have strayed away from that. It's it's unfortunate. I mean, there've been a lot of advances through research, but I don't know as a whole that we're teaching the students as well as we could if we had at least certainly undergraduate and probably master's level students as well as we could if we had more of that kind of interaction. But that's not the way university reward systems work these days.
Until you get to be a full, it's really dangerous to think about doing some of those things. I mean, it's you'll never get promoted.
Yeah.
I remember Ray Kreisig saying, you know, Bob, stay out of the lab. I got to build the lab up. And, you know, it takes 2 years. And then he said, look what happens. The dean or the department chair call you in and say, well, Holtz, what have you done? Well, I've been building the lab. Well, when are we going to see some results? And it takes you 5 years, you know, 2 or 3 years by the time you get experiments done until you get the results. And, and then it's too late.
It doesn't help your H index.
Terrible.
Yeah.
So I think that was good advice. I didn't follow it exactly because I loved the lab. But anyway. Yeah, I really feel sorry for, I think we've done exceptionally well with those two guys.
Yeah.
Mike and Brett, they are wonderful. And I'm so glad that they like it here and that they're doing well.
Yeah, they're fantastic. This is Mike Gomez and Brett Maurer for the audience who doesn't know who
that's
who
right.
We're speaking about two assistant professors in the UW geotechnical group. I fear that we're scaring people away from the area and the profession and maybe just academia, but there are also a lot of really amazing tools and things that are available now that people like Brett and Mike are working on and working with that are really exciting for what the future holds in geotechnical engineering.
That's great.
We're getting close to where we should be wrapping things up, I think here. But do you have any advice, comments you'd like to pass along to younger people, both in practice and academia, for establishing a successful, rewarding career in geotechnical engineering?
Well, don't be afraid to get your hands dirty. That was a wonderful experience for me working in those tunnels at Oroville, and even if I did lose my hearing. I learned a lot seeing how things are built and then the difference between what you put on paper and what actually happens in the real world. And I've seen it many, many times, and from a site investigation all the way through where things are assumed, but ain't the way it is when you get out in the real world. And I think just remembering that, if we can tell our students that, I think that's one of the most important things that they can learn. And then the other thing is, or that they can do, the other thing they can do is get active in a professional society or a professional organization, whether it's local or national, as soon as you can. I think the contacts and so on are invaluable in building up, or valuable, I guess I should say, in building up your credibility as a professional.
Mm-hmm.
And I love to see that happen with young guys, young folks, young guys and gals. I think it's a wonderful profession, and it's certainly been good to me.
Yeah,
I'm so glad that I didn't switch out when I was a sophomore and I was really kind of not sure I wanted to do this. Couldn't think of anything else. It's been great. And I'm glad that I chose to go with the academic route too. That's been very rewarding. Yeah. But that, I don't know if that means that's the same thing every other young professional should do.
Yeah. Well, we're all glad you did. Also, Bob,
on
behalf of all your students and colleagues and the geotechnical profession, thanks for all that you've done for everyone. It's been great talking to you and seeing you again, and hopefully we'll see each other soon in person.
Yeah, I would really enjoy that, Steve, and all the best to you and Diane and the girls. I can't say the girls, the women.
That's right.
Okay. All the best. And thanks for doing
this. You're freaking as well.
Okay.
Great.
Cheers. Bye-bye.
Okay.